that all, but that kid's getting ducked down the back of the goose.
Okay, so this is the focus workshops with Douglas Feenhoff, and today now is Sunday, the 3rd of March, and this is the first of two sessions. Slay them.
I know you would never do it, but I'm reminding myself to put my off.
What is your name? Janelle.
Tanel.
Tanel. Oh, welcome. You haven't been here the first 2 days, have you? No. Anybody else who wasn't here either of the first 2 days? And what is your name?
Caitlin.
Caitlin. Hi. Welcome. We are going to start with meditation today, and so Tanel and Caitlin will be able to find out what we've been up to. This will be a review meditation in which we will practice what I have been preaching. And so you can, with this meditation again, choose your favored position, of which you might have two at this point, either sitting or lying in Shavasana. And so Tanel and Caitlin, if you would like, you are very welcome to lie in Shavasana for this. It's a very important position, meditation position, to learn to manage. And you might find some particular benefits in it that you haven't experienced in sitting position so far. Chris, is there? Yeah, welcome back. When you hear the bell, your Pavlovian response is to settle your body in its natural state. Imbued with relaxed ease, stillness, and vigilance. Bring your attention from the physical surroundings, from the surroundings of the room, to physical sensations within your body. Noticing first that solidity where you contact the floor or your seat. This is your gateway to the physical sensations of the body. And give your present moment attention to whatever physical sensations you notice. Whether it be an itch or some tension, and if you note any tension or pain, let your breath be drawn to it and release it on the out-breath. So with every exhalation, you are relaxing more and more deeply, as if with an inaudible sigh. You're establishing that most important base of relaxation, which is the foundation of all higher concentration. And now establish that first balancing act of relaxation and clarity. You're training your mind to break that habitual association of clarity or of relaxation and dullness. You notice whatever clarity you have to begin with. And if that diminishes, you refresh your interest in your meditation object, which is physical sensations. You refresh that on the in-breath. So that you are balancing relaxation and clarity. Or alertness. And now we begin to introduce stability to your meditation, without dislodging that balance of relaxation and clarity, by giving it a more precise object to focus on, the physical sensations of the breath at the abdomen. Let your breath settle in its natural state. Give up all control. Noting only whether your breath is long or short as you give your full present moment of attention to the physical sensations of the movement of the abdomen as you breathe in and out. If watchfulness alerts you that your mind has become distracted by some fantasy of the future, some memory of the past, as soon as you notice it, your new reflex is to relax, release, and return your full present moment attention to the physical sensations of movement of your abdomen as the air enters and leaves your body. And now shift your attention to the more subtle object for your mindfulness, the physical sensations of the breath as it passes the rim of your nostrils. This demands greater acuity of your attention. Your attention is a stable gatekeeper at the rim of your nostrils, It is physical sensations that you are noting, rather than a mental image or a map of your body. The key to stability is the exhalation. Give it your full attention all the way to the last moment at the pause before spontaneously the weight of the atmosphere fills your body again with a new breath. The length of your meditation session is one cycle of in-breath and out-breath. And you apply the antidotes to dullness and excitation on each in-breath and out-breath, relaxing more deeply with each out-breath and refreshing your interest in your object, brightening your attention with each in-breath. You can count your breath if that is helpful, punctuating the final moment of the out-breath. And now for 3 minutes, without further instruction, settle your mind in stability and vivid attention on physical sensations of the breath as they pass the nose. You can expand your awareness again to the room. If you are lying in Shavasana, stretch your fingers and toes. Stretch and roll over to your right side. And sit up. Are there any questions based on that review meditation that we did or anything that we've covered to this point so far? Oh, I see.
Yeah, morning.
Peter. Hi.
When you end at the breath, monitoring the breathing that's coming in through the nose. Is the commitment to stay there, or can you, if you just start developing a pain or something from your posture, an itch or something, can you go back to relaxing that part of the body or dealing with that and then come back to the nose, or do you stay with that fine tuning?
So that's a good question. So if you are experiencing a pain and your object of mindful attention is a physical sensation at the tip of the nose, you would return, that pain would be a distraction then, in right now. And then you would, because that would be one distraction. If you attend to that or engage that pain and do something about it, very likely there will be something else the next moment. So what you're doing is training your attention to ignore, you know, really to note but not engage distractions, because distraction has gotten your attention, but what you do is that you're training your mind with this rope of mindfulness to stay focused on your object. And if you reach a point that it's impossible, if there's so much pain, for instance, in sitting, then what you can do is just, for one, you can take the physical, actually you shouldn't do this at this point. You should just, because this is shamatha and not vipassana. If this were vipassana, for instance, there could be great benefit in shifting your attention, especially if you were investigating the three marks of existence in the domain of feelings, to investigate the feeling of liking, disliking, sensation, etc. But that's really an application of this mindfulness. So, the best thing to do is to return to your object at the tip of the nose. And then, it just seems like there are, again, more and more benefits to having short sessions within the longer session. So if you had a 6-minute or 10-minute session that you had decided I have a half hour, I'm doing 5 6-minute sessions, for instance. You would be able to adjust your posture, for instance, between the 6-minute sessions without training your mind in the wrong direction to give in to distraction. Yes, Jen.
With the watcher, how often are you toggling in the cycle of one in-breath and one out-breath? I personally was finding it a little, I'd feel stable, and trying to get into the watcher view was a little destabilizing. So how often do you toggle?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I've heard different advice about that. And one teacher suggested, train yourself to check in every 6 or 7 breaths, something like that. I don't know. You could try that and see if that works. So that's the advice that you hear most frequently, is to train watchfulness to check in periodically. Obviously, it can't be constant, or that becomes the object of your attention. So you can do that, check in, try to check in, and then it's almost as if you have another watchfulness that is alerting you whether you're checking in or not. Becomes a maybe that's the more elementary approach that you will begin with. And then there's something that in many of the instructions is just hinted at or glanced at, and I've never seen it fully explicated. And I would be delighted to hear a source that does explicate this more fully. But I think maybe you can experiment with this. And actually what we're going to do, we'll have a lot more experience with this later in the afternoon. And this is, instead of checking in periodically, what you do, and so what would that be? That would be like a sentry who is making the rounds. So you've got the gatekeeper and then the sentry who is making the rounds, walking the perimeter and coming back to this gate every 7 breaths, something like that. So that would be perhaps that metaphor. Another possibility would be that your watchfulness becomes a motion detector. And so what you're doing is training your watchfulness to detect motion without actually checking in all the time. But there's an alert that goes off whenever it detects motion. And so we're going to really begin to develop that in the next meditation that we do, because we are going to shift to a different object. And then you're really going to get, remember, this is the value of having an object that is constant enough, as the breath is, as a rock is, so that you notice when the object has changed. And so this then, in that sense that we talked about the distinction between awareness and attention last night, and I think I mentioned that, about how you train awareness so that if a watchfulness is actually right hemisphere awareness, how do you train awareness? It's with what you give attention to. And then awareness, because it's aware of the whole ecosystem, including the left hemisphere attention, that your right hemisphere can be trained to be a motion detector. And that then, when you're able to do that, you are able to do what we're going to be talking about when you reach level 3. So level 1 is you are able to, shamatha level 1, is that you're able to place your mind on your object, find your object, first of all, great virtue of the breath as an object, and keep it there for a few seconds. So you all were able to do that very readily in this meditation. I know that. And then level 2, you are able to keep your mind on your object for around a minute, something like that. You know, so some nice substantial increase in your stability. So we're generally talking about stability here, or that's the definition more or less of these stages for the first 4 stages. But remember we said yesterday, in order to get from level one to level two, the challenge is not to become bored with your object, and that is the job of clarity. Because as you're going to find out when you're snowbound in your tent for 3 days and you count the stitches, it's impossible to become bored. And this is the hypothesis that you're going to be experimenting with, right? As you make your daily rounds, you have a number of things. You're going to be like a scientist now who is checking out these hypotheses. And one of these is that it's impossible to be bored if your mind is clear. So you're going to check it out, and we're all going to get together and compare notes. Because, you know, this isn't dogma that we're talking about. We're talking about an empirical, experimental approach to discovering our own minds. So that's level two. Level three, then, that we haven't talked about now, is that you are able to keep your mind on your object for a period longer than you're off your object. So more than 50% of the time you're on your object. This is a very nice, substantial development in your stability. And in doing that, you are patching the gaps, it's called. You are able, the reason that you're able to spend more time on your object than away from your object is because you are patching the gaps. Your watchfulness is alerting you when you leave your object more readily. So to get from level two to level three, you really have to begin to develop watchfulness, so that when you are abducted with the chloroform rag and thrown in the trunk, you don't end up in Barstow, but you may end up in Pasadena, you know, before you wake up. What's that?
They're different directions.
Oh, are they? Oh, okay. Yeah. But the point is, you still want to be at Venice Beach rather than in either one of those places, right? So that's the job. You really have to, you're developing clarity and watchfulness to get to level three. And then when you're at level three, so it seems like either at level three, you're very good at beginning to, well, it would be interesting. Somebody could do the math. Could you get to level three if you were checking in every seven breaths and you were, you know, off for six breaths? And beyond the breath on your object more than 50% of the time. It doesn't seem like it. So it seems like your watchfulness really has to be getting better and better at noting and alerting you more quickly when you leave your object. You know, so that and that then, as you noted, if it's going to do that, can it possibly do that? How does it do that? Are you beginning to check in every two breaths then? That then would begin to be pretty distracting. And so you have to make this shift then, it seems to me, from being a sentry to getting the alarm company to come out and install a motion detector. Yeah. Marv.
Yeah. One way it might be thought of is, hello. Later, when you will talk about the object being dismissed to the periphery and then in the center, opens up this whole question of focus and field. Which in a way are going on at the same time. You're actually going back and forth. But watchfulness hovers gently in the periphery and is always there. But it's there so softly as to not interfere with the object being center. So.
Yeah, good. And thanks for that. And we'll talk about that. Introduce that idea of peripheral attention or awareness with level five. But that's, yeah, that seems to be what's happening there. Maybe. I'm not, so there's, yeah. So we'll investigate. We'll investigate that. Lauren.
Sorry. So did everybody else get missed? Anyway, when you say that we're focusing on the tactile and not the mental image, what I find myself doing is I can find the tactile when I'm working on it kind of intensely, and then very, very quickly I find myself at the mental image of the nose and the breath and the little hairs and all of that kind of stuff. So it's under normal circumstances or in other meditations, I wouldn't have called that losing the object because I'm still in the ballpark of the nose.
Yeah.
But for this, as soon as I've moved away from the tactile sense, you know, it's like I only have that tactile sense for really, you know, milliseconds. And then it moves away again. So, I don't know, it's a lot harder than I would have thought.
Yeah. And I think that you only know that because your mindfulness is getting better. And it's exactly like with level one, it seems like your mind is getting more distracted because you're noticing what's going on. But it is, you know, so we don't give enough, have enough respect for bare attention because we think we're doing it when perhaps we're not. And because we are so habituated to that left hemisphere representation of our immediate experience, and this, I think, is part of the, genius of this 2,500 years of experimenting with this is that they figured that out, that there is a shift. It requires something different than conceptualizing because you are not, when you're paying attention to the physical sensations, what that appears to be is a right hemisphere attending rather than a left hemisphere attending. And so the especially physical, when you're attending to physical sensations of the breath, what the PET scans, or maybe it's another type of scan imaging, is showing is that, as I recall, it's the right temporal lobe that seems to be getting the blood. So that it's a way, then, interestingly, of so that those physical sensations, yeah, Lauren's comment, I think, should inspire us all to ask whether we really are attending with bare attention in the feeling there is only the feeling, right? Or the felt. In the felt there is only the feeling, you know. That and to begin to distinguish that, and that's the power of even this most fundamental meditation, when we're attending to physical sensations, is that we are training our bare attention. And so we don't want to fool ourselves. Lindsay.
Thank you. There are times when I contact a sensation and immediately my mind says, oh, great, a sensation, right? My knuckles on the floor. Immediately, my mind goes to the other knuckle across the way on my left hand and says, oh, the knuckle is not on the floor on my left hand, and off I go. It's almost like a little dance I'm doing, trying to find sort of pinpoint locations. Immediately, some kind of narration seems to come in.
Yeah.
What do I do?
Relax, release, return.
All right, okay.
Yeah, so the thing that both of you, I think, are noting is that when there's a big distinction between the five sense fields and the sixth sense field of mental appearances. And that as soon as you confuse tactile sensations with a conceptual or mental image of it. You are have entered this other field of the mind, and then it's as if the chloroform rag is already, you know, coming around at that point. As soon as you lose the tactile sensations, what comes next after that conceptual map? Because that's the remember, we are giving our attention an object, or our mind an object of mindful attention, because if we don't give it something to focus on, in comes immediately that ruminating present and past that we are familiar with every moment of our waking life.
So is your attitude towards the ruminating mind is, I mean, the immediate thing then is to go, damn, I'm narrating, and to take some sort of attitude towards it. But then the thing would be just to breathe out,
yeah,
just to follow the breath, and then see what sensation comes next.
Yeah, depending on what your object is.
Yeah, in terms of the tactile sensation, see what.
So when in that diffuse tactile sensations of the first, when we just begin our, mm-hmm, our, so we've already gone from the physical sensations of contact to the seat. We're just scanning the body for tension or any physical sensations. Yeah, so whatever comes up, and it's interesting that it can move pretty quickly from, you know, the eyelid. That seems so engaging, that itch under the eyelid, and it seems like it's a permanent thing. You know, that it's going to be there for the rest of your life. And then in an instant, then, if you're really attending to physical sensations, it can skip to a physical sensation at your big toe or something. And that's okay, because what we're doing is we're just focusing on physical sensations. And the point really of that is that we are relaxing. So we are attending to physical sensations because relaxation is our base point. You know, not that it's the, so that is not the best way to develop stability, I don't think. And that's not the point. The point is to develop that base of relaxation, because that base of relaxation, if you find tension or pain, you're going to release it on the out-breath. And so it's a way of developing relaxation, I think, rather than stability. Yeah, Mark.
Yeah, I don't know if this is helpful to both of you. But oftentimes, beginners are people who have been practicing for a while and then who get frustrated are bouncing off the object in this early stage of shamatha. It's often because once they find the object, they want to really see it clearly and sharply. But stability is accomplished through continuity, not through sharpness. So it's sort of like, you know, just like finding the center here. If you were looking for the center, you wouldn't want to try to see the address when you were in Pasadena. You'd want to get to the west side. Once you got to the west side, you'd want to get to this little complex around Jefferson, and then you'd want to find Arizona. And only when you get to Arizona become interested in the actual address. So, you know, that knuckle, I have that image of that, such a vivid image. But or you were talking about the sensation. If you notice the sensation, then as long as you're in the neighborhood of the sensation, you're there. And if you can stay in the neighborhood, then gradually a softening happens, and then you can start looking at what the address is. So I don't know. I hope that helps.
Yeah, and I think as long as that neighborhood is still within the domain of physical sensations.
Yes.
Because then you have left the planet, basically, of physical sensations, and there's no, and then once you've left the planet, you know, you're off in another domain. Mark.
I mean, I'm almost embarrassed to say this, but I'm going to say it just to say it. You know, in my almost 2 years of participating and meditating regularly, I feel like I've taken ground. And now I'm like having an experience like, it seems like an impossibility to have my mind be on the object for, I mean, I'm forget Barstow, I go to Zimbabwe. and like to keep my, you know, you talk about level three, staying on the object for a minute, you know, and now I'm like, I mean, and what's so great about this weekend is my distinctions are getting a little bit fine-tuned, but now it seems like a minute, I don't know because I know my mind and how like it'll bounce off, so it just occurring that it's impossible, is that part, that's part of this, right? Like, I'm in the right place.
Oh.
Does anyone else feel the way I'm feeling?
Yeah. Yeah, so actually what this is a meeting of Ruminators Anonymous. Yeah. Well, so imagine the change in your life. We're talking about, some lofty goals, but imagine the change in your life as you go about your daily rounds, if you could keep your mind on your object for 30 seconds. And that's certainly achievable. And part of this, I wouldn't doubt that for many of you who have never been able to do this, if by the end of the day today, even maybe you would have times when you'd have 30 seconds of continuity. So it's practice, and one of the things about this particular progression, I think, is that it seems like it works pretty nicely, and that's encouraging, and keeps you on your cushion at times that you would be less likely to. So yeah, it can be daunting, and you wouldn't expect to go from level one to level two without some significant practice to get there. And we'll talk more about how serious do you have to be about this at the very end of the day? How serious do you have to be to get results with this?
This particular study, and then when I finished those, I began a new series, which began with holding my mind on one object, which was, you know, and it was part of the first course of the second, you know, blah blah blah. And I was dumbfounded at the fact that I actually couldn't do that. After having done, you know, 2-3 years or 4 years of, you know, of the practice that we've done. And I worked at it a little bit, and then I went on to some other stuff. So now it's like coming back to that. Yeah, the analytical meditations work in like one arena or one domain, but what we're talking about now, it's like, starting from scratch. And for me, actually very exciting, because not that I am that great a meditator even in the analytical stuff, But it got to the, it did at some point at times get to a place where I had the feeling that with the analytical stuff there was a place, and I just couldn't step over that line. And I have the feeling that the line was there because I didn't learn this kind of stuff. So, if that helps.
Yeah. This is the remedial program of developing attentional stability that all of these great masters have told us to. And so the first step in doing that is forming a chapter of Ruminators Anonymous.
Yeah, I think we have to be really careful not to get frustrated, because it's exactly what both of you said about you've been practicing for years, but we're Ruminators Anonymous because we're Galoop Pods, I think, and because the way we went at it was so completely different. But what I was going to say, I'm actually more embarrassed than you, I think. What keeps going on in my mind is it even possible to feel something without narrating it? Like, because it's the same idea, can you ever not think, not have any thoughts, you know? And really you can't, as far as I know. You know, you might, the milliseconds in between, you might get to those gaps or pauses. But when Lindsay brings up narrating, I realize I still think I'm on the object. And then I started thinking, well, I'm always narrating to some extent. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how to make that distinction. And if I am off the object, or if I'm actually just thinking the way your mind has to be thinking.
Yeah. So that's the good point, Terry. This is part of the obsessive compulsive delusional disorder of our of our ruminating mind. And so the delusional part of that believes exactly what you asked. Is it possible? So remember, the left hemisphere believes that its conceptual representation of the world is all that does exist. So is it possible? The narrating mind will ask this question. Without my, this is the delusional part, it would say that without my narration of the world, nothing exists. I bring in the world into existence in my narration of it. And in fact, if I do not narrate an identity for myself, do I even exist? And so you had better be very cautious about trying to quiet me, because you might just be destroying your world, the entire world. You might be giving up. This might be death for you. And we're going to be experiencing that. And the answer to your question, you asked, is it possible for the mind not to have thoughts? I think you said thoughts,
yeah,
wasn't it? So we're going to be experiencing this afternoon the mind, I think that the fundamental of all point of all Buddhist psychology is that the mind is always aware of something. The mind is always aware of something. It is never not aware of something. But what is it aware of? And the conceptual left hemisphere, the narrator, would say that without narration, nothing exists. And we are going to experience the delusion of that very momentarily. And in fact, it is certainly possible to go for long periods of time. And in fact, this could be for you as a meditator, this could be the whole key to developing stability and vividness, is the absence of those thoughts, discursive thought, conceptual thought, conceptualizing mind, because what we're going to be doing is meditating with awareness as rather than attention. Then you are going to be, so, you know, the whole, in this progression, the whole, so we get to level three, which your mind is on your object. More than 50% of the time, you're patching the gaps. Level four, you are no longer afflicted with coarse excitation, meaning that you don't lose your object anymore in the sense that you lose it completely in coarse excitation. And this is because of your power of enhanced mindfulness. To get from level three to level four really requires, a refinement of mindfulness that is focused on the motion detector. So your motion detector becomes so finely tuned then. So obviously, you can infer the activity, you know, what the activity of, to get from level three to level four, if the sentry would just have to be traveling at the speed of light in order to never lose your object, right, if you were just checking in. So at this point then, the motion detector has to be finely tuned to alert you as soon as you are losing your object. So then it's said for about an hour or so that you are able to not lose your object. But still, that's only of nine, level four is not halfway there. So something else, there's a whole other career ahead, because it seems to all of us, not only to Mark, but to all of us, that if we had stability for an hour, meaning that we don't lose our object completely, that's probably the destination, right? I mean, what more is there after that? That is the goal of meditation. Yeah, but we're still not even halfway there. So this is something that we're going to investigate as we get to a more, how do we go beyond stability? Or is there, what could possibly be the goal beyond stability? Or of being able to keep your, to not lose your object completely anyway for an hour? That's pretty intriguing. Yeah, Jed.
I might be anticipating you, but I guess I'm just wondering, because I think in Prasangika training we're so trained to think that things only exist conceptually. So I'm very kind of confused by this idea that there is a way to experience a world that's not conceptual, because I thought the whole idea is that that is interdependence, is that's why the world exists for us, is because we're laying concepts on top. And without the concept, there would be no experience.
Yeah, so what's the question then?
So I'm asking, I guess, if we're saying that there's a way to experience a world with bare awareness that's not in a conceptual overlay, how does that jive with the whole Prasangika charge?
With the whole what?
Prasangika charge of that the world is just conceptual. It seems kind of against that whole kind of philosophy to say that there's a way to experience a world that's not just a concept.
No, Prasangika doesn't say that at all. That the world only exists as concepts. What Prasangika says is that whatever it is that exists out there, my only epistemologically, the only knowledge that I can have of it is my perception of it. And so perception is a lot different than saying a conceptual knowledge. And a mental image, if you're thinking that a mental image is a conceptual thing, conceptual object, that's a big obstacle. And in, so how could you possibly experience the world in a non-conceptual way? We talked, so isn't it interesting that we could be sitting here and even asking that question? Doesn't that, so the whole point of this title of the Master and His Emissary is that there has been a coup staged. So this is the Nietzsche's story, that there's been a coup. There's the master who is, in this analogy, the right hemisphere. The right hemisphere is the essential hemisphere in dealing with the world. Anything that is new has to enter there. The left hemisphere then does the conceptual elaboration. But in that so the coup is, that has been staged since the Industrial Revolution, is that there's no longer that oscillation or frequent oscillation or cooperation, because these are two very distinctly ways of looking at the world. And so the conceptual left hemisphere has staged the coup and has succeeded to the point that we can believe that the only way the world can possibly exist is the narrator brings it into existence. So that's proof of the success of the coup, that we would have that belief. So how does a musician, so music, dance, there are all kinds of extraordinary ways of experiencing the world that are non-conceptual, even though they have, many of these experiences have been co-opted by the conceptual brain. There are still lots of ways of experiencing and having those non-conceptual experiences, and you all have them, even though to make sense of them, you still conceptually translate them. So now that you know about, have this as a framework, you're going to become a lot more aware of this experience of a non-verbal, non-lingual, non-conceptual experience of the world. So intuition, mystical experiences, all kind nature experiences, dance. So dance and music are especially the province, and art, depending on what type of art, poetry, understanding metaphor, jokes. Understanding jokes, if you're don't get the punchline, it's because you're, you know, kind of muscle bound concepts with concepts, because humor is the province of the right hemisphere. Anything that's implicit rather than explicit, ambiguity is right hemisphere. So we don't even all of this stuff. Even understanding language is largely a right hemisphere activity. It was, for a long time, it was thought that language was only the province of the left hemisphere. But understanding the implicit meanings of language, symbolic language, metaphor, is all right hemisphere. But the left hemisphere takes all the credit, because that's the coup that has been staged. And so to do that, we're going to experience that. And I think that is part of the, you know, we need to examine within our presentation of Buddha Dharma whether, so we really need to, Lam Rim, you know, it's a long, long story, and maybe sometime we'll come and do a whole long Lam Rim presentation, because this is one of my favorite things to do is Lam Rim, and talk about the three-step dance in Lam Rim, of how you get from concept to realization at each step of the way of the about 170 topics. That's, I haven't counted them, but that, you know, the many, many, many topics of meditation that Pabanka Rinpoche says, without quiescence, you are not going to be able to have experiential realizations. And so Pabanka Rinpoche says the concepts are nothing analytic meditation is designed entirely to have what he calls uncontrived experiential realizations of all of these analytic meditation topics. So the concepts are stage two or step two of the three-step dance. And the coup says that that's all there is. That's all you need. Liberation occurs when you add A plus B plus C plus D. The equal sign is Satori, and on the other side is liberation. But you have to have A plus B plus C plus D. So, oh, I don't have X, Y, and Z yet, so I need to go out and in the spirit of spiritual materialism, go collect another set of concepts from some other teacher who's coming through town. And then once I have X, Y, and Z, there's the equal sign and there's liberation on the other side. And that's the coup, you know? That's proof of the success of the coup. At some point, it's helpful, so you can either, or we'll talk about that, the discovery versus developmental models of Buddhism a bit. But so the whole Lam Rim also is designed to lead to non-conceptual experiences. And I get into trouble on the debate ground with that term, but quote, non-conceptual, meaning non-discursive, that direct the uncontrived experiential. This is, Pabanka Rinpoche used that term, experiential, which means right hemisphere. You've got to take the third step. And if you're stuck in the second step, you know, it's helpful. There's no doubt that it's helpful. But there's so much greater potential. And that's what your teachers are trying to do, is to instruct you on taking that third step. And there are many different ways of doing that in different traditions. Okay. Yeah, Kelly. No, I think we are moving on as you ask these questions. So yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
Oh, let me just ask your question, and then I may say one thing before I answer that one.
Okay.
Okay.
In the Buddhist teaching, we discuss how if you have good morality, the pond is still enough to see the reflection of the moon. And so morality is a way to have a stiller meditation.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering with shamatha, if it's more of a practice, because it seems that it's not necessarily wisdom that can lead you there, because you can still achieve it and have pride about it. And I feel like when you approach it with a motivation to be there for other people, like when I teach choreography, I feel like I have some form of shamatha, but when I'm just trying to still my mind and the motivation, I don't remind myself it's for other people. I fly off. So I'm kind of wondering the correlation between your motivation and the importance of why you're trying to still your mind, I guess.
Yeah. A good question. Well, we're going to talk about that in the whole outline of this progression of ideas. This actually comes at the end. So I'll talk more about that at the end. But you raise a very good point. What is the motivation for doing this type of practice? I outlined at the very beginning a lot of different motivations that you could have, and that of the 16 million people doing yoga, 15.8 million are doing it for health reasons. And that's of the 16 million people who are probably next year going to be doing mindfulness type meditations, 15.8 million of them will be doing it for health benefits also, because they will have heard that cortical thickening is possible with mindfulness meditation, or lowering their blood pressure or whatever. But that depending on your motivation for undertaking this practice, all kinds of other things are possible, such as having that experience of watching yourself construe reality as in the moment that you do it. And then that becomes a experiential, uncontrived, or uncontrived experiential realization. So we'll talk about and the importance of morality in stilling the mind, and loving kindness, and bodhicitta. How does that affect your progress through these stages? So we'll talk about that. And then in the meantime, before we get there, it's very, very interesting, this whole idea of having goals. So how does this, I sat with, I'm very inclusive, as Lama Marut says, in my practice and my interest these days, and find great, great benefits in the ecumenical dialogue with other Buddhist traditions, with other spiritual traditions, and so it's and then you know, just talking with them, because we have one finger, as Lama Marut said last night, you know, pointing at the moon, and people have different predilections that they, you know. For me, when I first encountered Vajrayana and disillusion practices, it was like coming home, you know. That was just something felt very familiar. For other people, it's so foreign that it's crazy and a waste of time, you know. So it's part of the global richness that we have these days that, you know, we don't, unlike Theos Bernard, who went to Tibet 75 years ago, you know, in one neighborhood in Los Angeles, you might have 10 different approaches, and all of them have something. So the different traditions also have different ideas about how valuable it is to have goals for your practice. And so when Alan Wallace asked Gayatri Rinpoche, probably at a teaching that Marv was at, Gayatri Rinpoche gave an answer I think that is really, really helpful in this shamatha practice of ours. Of course you have to have goals for your practice. You know, why would you even do it? And if you have a lofty goal, because you sense that it's somehow the whole potential of this human life somehow depends on the loftiness of your goal, you know, it really inspires you to practice with intensity and diligence, and to get you onto the cushion if you're doing it for other people as well as yourself. You know, other people are suffering in the same way that you are, you know. And so they're having a lofty goal of perfecting, reaching your own human potential so that you can help other people reach their human potential, changes the game dramatically. However, so it's really helpful to have goals and signposts, Master Kamala Shila's 9 stages to know where you're at, etc. All of that is really that, all of that is very conceptual left brain elaboration. It's very helpful. However, within a session, once you sit down on your cushion, then being dissatisfied, having a goal for that particular session, is an obstacle in shamatha practice. Are you unhappy with your distraction? Or is it what your mind is presenting to yourself, to what is presenting? And your dissatisfaction is a distraction. You know, is that conceptual distraction? So what you do is you notice what's going on. You notice that you are conceptually distracted, that, and you relax, release, return. And the goal of having a perfect stability is an obstacle, because it's a conceptual representation of your present moment of experience, that I am unhappy with my present moment of attention, etc. So there's that fine, very, I think, helpful distinction of having goals that motivate your whole practice and your life. And then when you get to your session that you have no goal, you are accepting what arises, even though you are mindfulness is focused on an object. So it's not that you're willing to say, I have no goal even for mindfulness in this session, because mindfulness does have an object. And when watchfulness alerts you, you are relaxing, releasing, and returning to your object. I saw something, and I don't mean to, in our ecumenical dialogue, I just want to point out a distinction without being critical or judgmental, because I don't know enough about some of these things and why would you be judgmental? But there's a distinction, I think, that you could draw between, for instance, saying, as I heard one very, very famous teacher describe on a Google or a YouTube presentation of mindfulness meditation that had already 1.7 million views, that how many people of you fell asleep in our, so he asked this, you know, did a 5-minute meditation, how many people of you fell asleep? You know, and 5 people raised their hands. And then he said, well, that's no problem. When I was 15 years ago, there at a Zen center, there were 5 Roshis who came from Japan to dedicate the Zen center, and all of them fell asleep during the ceremony. So maybe your problem is not falling asleep, but the fact that you think it's a problem to fall asleep. Well, I think that's really not having a goal for your session. And I probably don't just understand how that is as beneficial it's a different definition of mindfulness that he operates with, you know, overtly. But in the Shamatha traditions and in the Pali Canon, according to Bhikkhu Bodhi, who is one of the great translators of the Pali Canon, that approach to mindfulness is not found in the Pali Canon, but comes out of Krishnamurti, you know. But in our approach, within a session, mindfulness is placing your mind on an object. So it's that balance. But having being upset about having lost your object, it's a problem, you know, and that's an obstacle. So there's a big distinction between having goals for your practice, for your life, and then having a goal within the session, you know, and insisting that it go one way rather than another. Because then you are not mindfully present for what is happening in your session as it unfolds, moment to moment. Okay, so at level 5, then, so through the 4 levels, the first 4 levels where we're working on stability, you're either on your object or you're off your object, really. That's because you're working with coarse excitation you're working with coarse excitation and coarse dullness to get through the first 4 levels. When you reach level 4, then coarse excitation is no longer a problem. And then to get from level 4 to level 5, you're beginning to notice something different called medium excitation. And this is a phenomena then that you're going to be a pretty good meditator before this even becomes an issue for you. And this is what this phenomena that Marv was talking about, where you have an object that is your focus, your target, and then there are peripheries around that, orbital shells of an electron or something. So is it possible to be aware of 2 things at once? So with coarse excitation, you have an involuntary object. You have lost your chosen object, at the center of your focus, but it still remains on the periphery. So you haven't lost it altogether. So with medium excitation, you have an involuntary object at the focus of your attention, but you haven't lost your object altogether because it's still hovering there in the periphery. So are you aware of both of those simultaneously? It doesn't seem that way, and I have always struggled with, or I've been somewhat skeptical about this whole atomistic approach to attention and awareness. You know, does it flow as in a river, or is it bursts of as ascertaining awareness with the 20 milliseconds, and et cetera, et cetera? Well, so it's interesting that cognitive research seems to be substantiating what Buddhist psychology says, that it is atomistic at the level of consciousness anyway, so at the level of our awareness. And then when you begin to get into the embodied realism, and that the whole like George Lakoff, perhaps there are all kinds of unconscious. So 95% of our mental processing probably is still unconscious. And so for that 5%, it requires that 20 milliseconds of duration before it makes its way into that, to become an ascertaining moment of consciousness or something like that. So it could be still somewhat, you know, the same, that there's a stream, but still to reach awareness, or to become aware of it, I should say, it still has to have some length of duration, temporal duration of 20 seconds, milliseconds, 10 milliseconds, and then perhaps 5 milliseconds. Yeah, Geneva.
You brought up attention and awareness. And
that was, that came up yesterday as well. And I'm wondering if you could go into that a bit more, like with metaphors or just a way to understand the difference between awareness and attention. I know yesterday we said like attention is like specific and then awareness is like global, and like one is left and one is right. But it seems that in this stage, that difference is really key.
Yeah, it's really key in the next meditation that we're going to be doing when we shift to another object. But at this point, I think you can still have, and I'm not sure which is the more apt, peripheral awareness or peripheral attention. And I think it's probably actually peripheral attention. So peripheral attention is one, would be left hemisphere, taking focused on a single object. Awareness would be being aware of many things simultaneously, creating a single picture of many things simultaneously, like a global awareness. So it would be the right hemisphere type of global awareness versus left hemisphere attention on a single thing plucked out of the myriad of the cloud of potentiality of quantum mechanics to manifest one thing, to focus on, define conceptually, to manipulate. But that peripheral, I think it's probably more apt to call it peripheral attention at level 5. So it seems like that's again toggling. But the level 3, we introduce this concept of patching the gap, where you're off the object. The duration that you are off the object is so short, brief, that you're able to resume almost. It's like you have momentum, in a sense, from one stable moment, this continuity. Even though you have toggled to another object, there's continuity. So there is, so one metaphor that you hear in that continuity is water flowing under ice, schools of fish. I forget how that one worked. I don't know. I remember snorkeling in Thailand and thinking that was really apt, but I can't remember why now. But so you're patching. I think this is what's happening also with the toggle, that you are patching the gap so quickly that there's momentum between what's in the center and what's in the periphery, so that you, it seems like you can be aware of these things, you know, almost simultaneously, because the gap of the toggle is short. And so it's almost like you're, with your main object, you're have enough momentum to get over the to the next moment of continuity onto the same object. Some momentum of continuity. Yeah, Peter.
I'm starting to get a little lost here. The and as far as I'm and understand it to this point, the fine object is your nostrils.
Yeah.
Once you move from the coarse object of your abdomen, you're at the finer object of. So these other things, these peripheral things you're talking about, these are distractions that are
yep.
are trying to claim your attention.
That's right.
And so the toggling is between the force of these attractions and your principal object, which is your nose. That's still where I am.
That's right. Yep. Yeah. So thanks for that question. So in the case where your object of mindful attention is the physical sensations at the tip of the nose, when your stability becomes so good, so until you're at level four, we'll say, you're either at Venice Beach or you're in Barstow. And then at level five, you might be, how does that go? So maybe that's not the best way to describe it. Back to the metaphor of the radio station. So with the metaphor of the radio station, with coarse dullness, we are headed to Barstow and the, not in being Shanghai'd, the radio station just fades out altogether and there's no signal whatsoever. With coarse excitation, we start here, tuned to NPR, 10 blocks north, only Rush Limbaugh. With medium excitation, we're headed north, and Rush Limbaugh is the dominant signal, but we can still hear NPR in the background. So it's as if we're getting both signals at once. But Rush Limbaugh is the dominant one. So in the case then of our object of our mindful attention is the physical sensations at the tip of the nose, in the earlier levels of stability, until we get to level four, we're either on it or off it. And we go off for typically 10 minutes, and then we recover our object. But once we get to this other level of level five, where we can have peripheral attention, we don't really lose the physical sensations at the tip of the nose, even though it's not in the center. There might be an involuntary, I might be thinking about lunch, but I haven't lost, there's like a momentum also in the peripheral attention. So it seems like there's, what it seems like is that we're patching the gaps so that the gaps are short enough that there's momentum of continuity so that we haven't lost our object. We're toggling, but we're toggling. We haven't lost the object, our chosen object, completely, because we're toggling back and forth from the involuntary object to the object of our choice.
So toggling is actually the avoidance of the distraction, or the trying to not succumb to the distraction.
Yeah. So that's right. So because we are able to toggle, that's just the way the mind operates. We haven't lost the object completely, in a sense. Even though in that 20 milliseconds, we have obviously lost or changed objects. But in a second, you know, there's enough momentum to get from 20 milliseconds. So it's probably 40 milliseconds of lunch and 10 milliseconds of breath awareness. And then but because every second we're checking in, toggling back to the breath, there's momentum, we're patching the gap. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Just have a short follow to it. So as I understand it, the stages we're at with shamatha is finding your objects, then second is staying with your object, third is keeping your mind on the object at minimum 50% of the time.
Yeah.
And fourth is coarse excitation.
So I should give you the name for that.
I have fifth is medium excitation. So fourth.
Yeah, so the fourth is called close attention. The title of that is called close attention. And the definition of it is that you have a degree. So these stages of shamatha, as you go through, are all defined by which obstacle is present. And so the obstacle at level four then is that you no longer have coarse excitation, but now you have medium excitation and coarse dullness still. So the excitation, as you go through these, you always get through the more subtle level of excitation before dullness. And so there's always dullness is, as you ascend through, you take care of the next most subtle level of excitation before you take care of the next more subtle level of dullness. So here at level four, it's translated as close attention. The obstacle is medium excitation. To get from level four to level five, you have to get past medium excitation and coarse dullness. Yeah, Marv, you had a comment?
Yeah, just to make it experiential, experiential and very simple, and everyone can do this right now for like 5 seconds, and that is you rest your attention on your breath, just enough to know inhale and out and exhale. Just do that, and as you're doing that, start to notice the flowers, the room, other things, and you'll notice you're able to stay with that, and yet there's some noticing of what else is going on, and actually it's how we function. So the qualitative shift here is that whereas in ordinary life we lose the object, and even in our meditation we lose the object, coarse excitation. When we hit stage four, where there's so much continuity and momentum and inertia of continuity, that when these other things appear, we don't lose that sense of being still connected. And everyone can do it right now for 5 seconds. And it's going to be key to your shift to settling the mind in its natural state.
Yeah. So one other way of describing that is this is one of the reasons when we go to get to retreats or in longer practice why walking meditation is such a good thing, because as Marv said, you can be focused on physical sensations of your step at the sole of the foot and still be aware of your surroundings as you're walking through them. I think that is a distinction between awareness, another distinction between awareness and attention. How, because we have two different types we have evolved, and we have this has contributed to our survival, to be aware of the whole global thing, which is why you can be texting while you're walking across the street as well. Even though you are attending to the keys, you are still hopefully aware of a sound of a car approaching or something like that, without and able to do somewhat, because it's, again, two different types of attention being given by two different hemispheres of the brain to the world. Yeah, Lindsay.
I need, if you could, give us your definitions of experiential, perceptual, and conceptual. I'm getting confused about how you are describing those.
Okay, so so experience is one of those things that is like pornography in Justice Potter Stewart's definition. It's difficult to describe, but you know it when you see it. Maybe. I don't know.
So,
so experience feels like the right hemisphere attending to the world, in that it is alive, it is ambiguous, it is implicit, it is something that impacts us in a felt way, you know, it is always multiplicitous. you know, it's a different, you just notice a difference, and perhaps you could say that it is, you experience the world of experience by noting the difference from what it is not, which is conceptual. So conceptual, I think, is a lot easier to get a grasp of, in that it is often that narrated thing. But it's conceptual is one thing plucked out of the myriad context of experience, which is ambiguous. And that so conceptual is often verbal, but there are physical you can have pictured concepts also, and those would be two-dimensional rather than three-dimensional. Those could be conceptions as well. You can have conceptual visual images so it's not strictly. And that's something I never would have guessed possible without this kind of precision of thinking about the left and right hemisphere difference. So, and that's one of the reasons that I introduced that whole framework, is because it seems like it's more precise way of describing that distinction between experience and conceptual. And then perception, generally, I think would say is preconceptual, you know, and that would be so without referring to Buddhist psychology, that would be the sensory awareness. So you can of sight of five senses, you know, would be perceptual. And you know, conceptual then is that shift to the left hemisphere. So I think we ought to just get onto a meditation, because, you know, one of the things about all the questions is that it's very helpful, but sometimes we lose the flow of what's going to, of the whole presentation. And And a lot of your questions are going to be answered as we move a little further. So once we then get to stage four in this presentation, we are presented with a fork in the road. So you can either then at level, to get from level four to level five, you can either stay with the same meditation object, which is the physical sensations of the breath at the tip of the nose, or, and so this is, I believe, what most of the Theravadan traditions do is go all the way, stay with the same object because it's a subtle physical sensation. And there's, you know, very many gradations. You just become more and more subtle physical sensations. So some many traditions just stay with the physical sensations within the body and of the breath all the way through the entire shamatha progression. So Master Padmasambhava, however, suggests that we choose another object. And the virtue of this other object is that it is a more subtle object also. And so it places, again, more demands on the acuity of our attention. And especially as we go through the progressions, the obstacle that we're going to be dealing with, now stability is no longer an issue. But physical sensations can lead, if we're focusing only on physical sensations, they can lead to dullness. And so we choose a more subtle object, which is settling the mind in its natural state. So what our object of mindful attention then, when we choose as our practice settling the mind in its natural state, is the space of the mind and the appearances that arise there. This then has, because it's such a subtle object, I may have led you to believe that we're going to start meditating immediately, but we're not. So, because I have to introduce this whole, what we're going to be meditating on. So we are going to be taking this more subtle object, the space of the mind, and its the appearances that arise there, because of the acuity demanded by that produces vividness of attention. So as we, to get from level five to level six and level seven, one of the major obstacles is dullness in, from coarse dullness, progressing from coarse dullness to medium dullness to subtle dullness, where we are, our attention is stable now, so we are not losing our object that way, but we can still be disengaging from our object because we're beginning to fall asleep and beginning to dream, or because that's coarse dullness. Or subtle dullness, we haven't lost our, or even medium dullness, we haven't lost our object, but our attention doesn't have vividness. So beginning with, when we have medium excitation and medium dullness, we're no longer losing our object, but we either the object isn't in the center of our focus, or our attention doesn't have vividness. So this idea of vividness is an interesting thing, and in so is it something that you can add to your meditation, like spice from a little cayenne, add a little cayenne to your curry, you know, to add vividness to your curry. I don't think so. What it appears is that vividness arises naturally as your attention becomes more and more stable. And so this leads then, so vividness seems to be a quality of your mind, of your attention, that you discover as your mind becomes more and more stable. So rather than developing, so in this presentation, because this is Padmasambhava's presentation, this is a discovery model of Buddhism. We don't develop vividness, we discover vividness, which is a quality of our mind as it becomes more stable. And this, I think, is really helpful to think of it in that way. And then if we venture into this practice of why do we do this, this practice is said by Master Padmasambhava and one of the great Dzogchen masters, Dujom Lingpa, to be especially beneficial, again, for people who are prone to excitation and distraction. So choosing this subtle object is really good, as you're going to discover, surprisingly, for developing stability. And the added benefit is that along with stability, you're going to get vividness in your meditation. So the object of this, of your mindfulness here, we are entering a different domain. Rather than physical sensations, we are entering the domain of our mind. And this is a different sense capability. So just right now, think of your mother. You have entered the domain of your mind. Is your mother appearing to you with an visual sense, with an auditory sense, with a tactile sense? You have brought your mother to mind. Your mother is the object of your attention, but it's a different appearance. It's appearing to a different sense faculty, which is this appearance in the six. In Buddhism, there are six senses. And the sixth is this mental faculty with the space of the mind and what appears there. So to practice without distraction then, when we take the appearance, this other more subtle object, to practice without distraction means something a little bit different. Because in the to practice without distraction when the breath was our object meant that the object, like the stone, didn't change. But here, what we are doing now is what it appears to me is that we are no longer practicing with attention, but we are practicing with awareness. So it's not that the object doesn't change, because what we are doing is taking the appearances of the mind as our, we're taking the space of the mind and what appears there as our object. And so the objects appearing to the mind are continually changing. What we are doing here is developing this capacity that Padmasambhava called the fusion of stillness and motion. And so to practice without distraction then means not that the object of our mindful attention has changed, because our motion detector watchfulness has been alerting us to the change in the object. The motion detector goes off when the object changes, which is why we chose the breath as our object, because it's constant enough to know when it has changed and when to alert the motion detector. Now, what our watchfulness is alerting us to, is motion not of the objects of our mindful attention, but a shift motion of our awareness. So what we are doing is our awareness is sitting at the beach, at Venice Beach, and watching the parade go by. And if we decide that, ooh, that tattooed guy is really intriguing, I'm going to join him on his stroll, watchfulness alerts us that we have, our awareness has gone off its still point of awareness. So what we are doing is now we are cultivating a still point of awareness from which we watch impassively the parade go by on Venice Beach. And we do that then, so there's a really beautiful metaphor of what that feels like. Are there any bird watchers here? This is the first place I have done that and not 10 hands have gone up. Okay. Yeah, which makes sense. You know, there are probably a lot more whale watchers here than bird watchers because that's what, you know, that's the environment. So anyway, there is this a bird called a kestrel, a falcon called a sparrowhawk. Has this very unique capacity to hover in midair. I would on my bike rides up the Twisp River, past an alfalfa field, I would encounter one of these periodically. A kestrel is able to surf into the wind. It's called kiting into the wind. And the way that they remain motionless in midair is not like a hummingbird, which is like a helicopter more, where it's beating its wings furiously. Or it's not like an eagle also, which I would see very frequently, many eagles on my bike rides or from my house in Twisp, which is in motion. Its wings aren't moving, but it's gliding in its gyre. So this kestrel does something really different. It remains motionless by kiting into the wind. It is facing into the wind. It could be a 20 mile an hour breeze, and it is continually adjusting its pin feathers in its wings and its tail to remain motionless relative to the ground, even though it's facing into this onrushing parade at Venice Beach. So it's not like the red-tailed hawk also on the telephone pole next to it. The red-tailed hawk can be motionless, again, in this face of a 20-mile-an-hour breeze, but it's doing that by just sinking its talons into the top of the telephone post. So that's cool, but it could be sleeping there. And a kestrel, if it loses its attention and isn't continually, moment to moment, modulating those pin feathers and tail feathers, it either is going to drop to the ground or it's going to be swept backwards. So this is the way that our attention needs to be a kestrel. We're giving moment-to-moment attention. Am I becoming dull? Am I becoming excited? Am I, in Dzogchen, the phrase is awareness holding its own ground. And this is what we want to do at Venice Beach. We want to hold our own ground on the beach and watch the parade go by without going off with one of these. So this is what watchfulness is alerting us to. Have I gone off with the tattooed man? You know, and guess what? The tattooed man is going to take you to Barstow. You know, you end up with 10 minutes of distraction because you have not impassively watched the tattooed man, what? Arise, abide for a time, and then just dissolve again as an appearance to your still point of awareness. This is the kestrel. Hold on. So this is the type of awareness that we need to, and watchfulness then, this is the capacity of watchfulness then, is going to alert us when we have lost, when awareness has lost its own ground and engaged an object. So our attitude for all of these appearances as they arise in the mind then, as they arise, abide, and dissolve, is to just impassively witness them. And without preference that they stay as it would be with a desirous object. Ooh, it's not the tattooed guy, but it's the girl, you know, who went by already one time, and now this time I'm not going to let her go. you know, so if it's a really desirous object, we would prefer that it stay, you know, from moment to moment to moment to moment to moment. Or if it's a very unpleasant thing, we would wish it to go. But we're not doing either of those things. We are just witnessing impassively as it arises, abides for a while, and disappears or dissolves. So we're going to just practice that, and then later we'll get into something else about where they arise from, where they dissolve back into. So for now, I want you to not ask questions for a moment, because your questions are going to be answered to you for you in your meditation. We are going to practice being a kestrel, taking our mindful attention. The object of our mindfulness is going to be appearances to the space in the space of the mind, and we are going to practice mindful. So that is the object, just focusing on whatever arises. And watchfulness then is going to alert us to has our still point of awareness. So this is, we're going to establish a still point of awareness, and watchfulness is going to alert you to when your awareness has gone off with the tattooed man. Okay? And you can ask questions about your experience afterwards. Okay, so find your, in this meditation then, it's recommended that you, sitting is going to be good. And that you meditate with your eyes open. And so if you haven't meditated with your eyes open before, your gaze is cast down, an unfocused gaze in front of you. Blink whenever you need to, you know, don't let your eyes dry out. Just relax. Your drishti is an unfocused point somewhere out, down in, you know, below the horizon line, 5 feet out in front of you or so. It's not that you're focused on some object in front of you, because the object of your mental, of your awareness, is not a visual image. You begin this and all your meditations by settling your body in its natural state. Bring your present moment attention from your surroundings in the room into your body, noting this feeling of solidity where you contact your seat. Note any points of tension within your body. And let your breath be drawn to those. And release them on the out-breath. Deepening your relaxation with every out-breath. Following it to the final moment before the pause. Now shift your attention to the physical sensations of the breath as it passes the nose. Your attention is a gatekeeper there. The key to stability is the exhalation. Give your full mindful attention to the exhalation, to the final moment. If watchfulness alerts you that you have become distracted by some sound, some thought of the future or the past, relax, release, and return your full present moment attention to the physical sensations at the tip of the nose. It's important to develop stability of attention before we shift to a more subtle object. Our main practice this session is settling the mind in its natural state. And to help you identify this different domain from tactile sensations, I want you to think of a phrase, a short phrase, perhaps something like, "Here is the mind." And then when I snap my fingers, to just bring that phrase to mind and repeat it to yourself, syllable by syllable, "Here is the mind." By doing that, you will have successfully watched a thought arise, abide, and then dissolve. You have found your meditation object, an appearance in the space of the mind. And then just keep your mind watchfully, mindfully aware of whatever appears in that space of the mind next. And impassively watch it arise, abide, and dissolve again. So when I snap my fingers, bring that phrase to mind. Your awareness is a still point. From which you watch the parade of appearances, impassively witnessing whatever arises there, whatever thought, whatever desire, without engaging with it, without being abducted by it. For however long it lasts, just watch it from your still point. Without preferring that it stay or preferring that it go. Let your awareness be a kestrel. Modulating your attention whenever watchfulness alerts you of dullness or excitation. Hovering motionless in midair. If watchfulness alerts you that you have lost your still point of awareness, your reflex is the same. Relax, release, and return to that still point of awareness. You can reset your parade by rehearsing that phrase of yours again, watching the syllables of that phrase arise, abide, and stay, and then dissolve. And then just witnessing what comes next. You are not expelling thoughts as they arise. You are impassively witnessing an appearance in the space of the mind. Let your awareness hold its own ground. Stillness in the middle of motion. Are there any comments or questions about that meditation? Yeah, Jed.
Did I hear you say to keep your eyes open too? Or did I just completely miss,
That? Why do that?
Oh, no. Is that what you said also, to keep your eyes open during the meditation? Oh, okay.
And why? You probably experience the reason why more so in the next meditation that we do. But I'll tell you, so there are all kinds of reasons for clarity, etc. The really interesting reason, I think, is that when in the next I think we'll do two more, another meditation before we get to this one, where we actually take the space of the mind as our object, that you can really begin to notice is there a distinction between interior space and exterior space, between the space in which thoughts arise and the space in which objects arise. And so with your eyes open, that can be very useful to in noticing whether they're the same or different, without really making it a Vipassana inquiry. I think that's, you know, that's what's said in the instruction, and very interesting that you begin to, without giving it away, I mean, the whole mind can begin when we go to lunch, you know, you probably won't do that until we get to the space of the mind. I mean, notice this. So that's it, basically. Yeah. Very profound. Yeah.
I found this really amazing thing. It's like entering a cathedral that you've heard about all your life in France or something, and you enter this door, and here you are finally in this place that you've been so concerned with all your life, that you've been aware of all your life. Here, like when you said, here is the mind. It's really, I found it just to be this amazing thing, but also in all the usual suspects are all stage fright.
Yeah.
They're not coming in, like they're all hanging back in the wings. So you had this space, this really wonderful space is how I experienced it. Just like you can feel the sound, like in the cathedral, you feel that the sound, the emptiness as a thing. You know? But
yeah.
But you don't, the usual suspects are all hiding. But I also felt that the anchoring of the exhalation was, I found that to be exactly that in the previous meditations, that it was anchoring. But I found myself toggling back to that anchor in the breath. So it was kind of like, okay, I know you're here, a small friend in the cathedral with you, who's the exhalation, and you're experiencing this sort of amphitheater, this space. And it just seems amazing to me. It seems like it's just kind of what I always thought meditation was supposed to be, but not really the experience.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah, thank you. That's very insightful, and that toggling back to the exhalation. Excellent. That's perfectly good, and then at some point maybe you won't even need that, because that still point will just be established. But yeah, experiencing that spaciousness is in. Very interesting experience for any of us. And so as a member of Ruminators Anonymous, what would the experience be like if this was all the meditation instruction that you got without having developed stability first with physical sensations? If all I did was to tell you to focus on whatever appears to the mind, as a card-carrying member of Ruminators Anonymous, we would be spending our day in Barstow, which is, you know, it'd be difficult to distinguish what we were doing from our everyday ruminating experience. And so that something about establishing stillness of attention allows us to reach that still point of awareness from which we can watch appearances arise within that spaciousness. And it be an experience that feels like it's something different than we have ever experienced before. Yeah.
I think I had the exact opposite experience of Peter, because I'm so used to meditating with my eyes closed. It was really a new experience. So I was kind of like, where did the cathedral go? You know, like it totally, I felt almost, I had anxiety. Because I was trying to didn't quite know what to focus on, didn't quite know how far I should raise my eyes. I even looked around at other people to see if they were, I was really uncomfortable, because I'm just not accustomed to meditating with my eyes open.
Uh-huh.
And so, yeah, there was no cathedral there.
Yeah, so maybe it's a little too much to ask to do, to be introduce you to both those things at once then. So try with the next one then, just meditating with your eyes closed, and maybe that'll be better for you. But when you do get used to, you know, you get used to it really quickly, meditating with your eyes open. And now, I mean, and it would, if you're like me, it'll soon become your preferred approach. And it, partly, I don't know why, because it just feels relaxed and natural and clear.
Yeah,
but whichever, yeah. Yeah. So it's again one of those choices that you would make along with your meditation position. My eyes open, my eyes closed, chin, gaze, you know, depending on what mindful attention is alerting you to for a particular session, that clarity or excitation is the issue that you need to be dealing with.
Sorry, yeah. But is it like, do I want to work my way up to meditating with my eyes open? Because I'm kind of bent on, I want to do it the right way.
Yeah, you will. You'll want to, especially because of the benefits of in this meditation, and especially when we take the space of the mind as an object. That's the advice, that you want to keep your eyes open, because it blurs that distinction, that boundary, in the same way that we lose when we're focusing on bare attention on physical sensations. Wow, this is a conceptual boundary. I wonder if the space of the mind and the space in which exterior objects appear might also be as easily blurred. Yeah. Steve.
Yes, thanks. My excitation is definitely down. I was battling the dullness, and maybe that's not the right word for it. It felt like I just drifted into the dullness. And part of my challenge included the eyes open in terms of, I was kind of staring at that leaf there. I know you said not to do visual, and perhaps it's that old left brain self-sabotager that wanted to put attention on that leaf there for some reason. But as I was even doing that, I had problems keeping my eyes open because I wanted to drift off into kind of sleep. Though my experience is that I feel more refreshed now after the meditation. But I was just wanted to ask you about how to, I tried the inhalation to try to stay out of the sleep mode, and it didn't seem like it was kind of doing it. Is there another tip to it in terms of the balance? And I was thinking about the bird.
Yeah, that's interesting. So I would guess that most of you didn't have a problem with falling asleep in this meditation. Is that right?
Oh. Your eyes will go to and your hand.
Yeah.
So I was totally off, and then it was kind of fighting actually between falling asleep and trying to grasp into something that I couldn't hold on to. So it was very challenging.
Ah. Yeah, so dullness anyway. This is a very good, choosing this meditation is a good one usually for fighting dullness, because the mind is such a compelling object, and it requires so much of your acuity of your attention to not be swept back or to fall to the ground. So in core, that just brings up a lot the remedies for coarse dullness in general. So the generally what you try to do is to apply an antidote that is sufficient to keep you from falling, of sufficient strength to keep you from falling into dullness again. So coarse dullness, meaning that you are about to lose your object because you're you're beginning to notice that you're almost dreaming. It seems like you almost enter a dream state before you start sleeping. So you want to apply an antidote that is sufficiently strong to so that when you, after applying the antidote, that you're not going to be nodding off again into dreamland for at least a couple of minutes. So ideally, that would be inhale, clarity. And so you might try that. You can try. So first of all, the goal is to apply an antidote in which you don't have to change your object. You know, so you would be just, and that's why that inhaling clarity is such a good one, because you don't have to lose your object in order to do it. You can also then, without losing your object, you can, if your eyes are closed, you can open your eyes. Remember the tip of the chin. That's a very good one. You don't have to lose your object to do that. If your eyes are open, you can raise your gaze. That's a good one to do that. At some point, if you have done all of those and you've exhausted those remedies and you still are falling asleep, after 10 seconds or 20 seconds after applying the remedy, then you probably have to do something a little more drastic, meaning that you probably have to shift your object away from, to an object that is going to invigorate you a little bit. So you can, for one, you can inhale deeply and take a couple of deep breaths, because sometimes, we all experience, that's what a yawn is really, right? It's, you kind of, your oxygen level just gets a little stagnated or something in the bottom of your lungs, or residual air at the bottom of your lungs, and you need to inhale a big fresh gulp of air. So you might just try inhaling deeply and so you focus on your breath for a little bit to inhale deeply, exhale. It's said also that you can exhale against resistance. Don't know quite what that means, like pinching your nose or something. You can then you create some muscular tension, do a little isometric to the point where your muscles start quivering a little bit. Things like that. Eventually, if that's not working, we're talking about escalating remedies here. You can change, if it really comes down to it, you can change your position. So the ultimate in doing that would be to stand up then, to adopt that standing asana, because that's it requires a lot of muscular tension, and so it induces clarity. It's hard to fall asleep while you're standing. And so you can, that might be sufficient then to do that for a couple of minutes, and then you can try sitting again.
One last thing is, I guess when you said choose a phrase, you gave a suggestion, and then I went to, I am not my mind. And I sifted into that.
Okay, good.
Maybe that also added to some of the dullness in some respects, meaning that I wasn't exploring the spaciousness of my mind. I was kind of trying to feel myself that I'm not my mind, which I believe in.
Oh, so you were almost doing an analytical meditation.
I'm sure, certainly there was a narrator.
Oh.
Yeah, no question about that. I don't ever deny that. There was a narrative going on. But maybe I was too analytical as you're,
Yeah.
But I went immediately to there instead of choosing the one that you said.
Yeah, so
I thought we had a choice.
Yeah, you do have a choice. Yeah, and for me, my particular choice is a favorite line from Walt Whitman: "A foot and lighthearted, I take to the open road." From "Song of the Open Road," and so that keeps me watching appearances a little bit longer as I pronounce those. But the whole idea is that you create some success. If I just tell you, notice what arises and abides, and we don't have any habit of success at that. So by rehearsing a phrase, bring it to mind syllable by syllable, you see a phrase arise, abide, and dissolve again. And then you can just go back to reset that. So yeah, choose whatever phrase you like. Jed.
So is this attention and awareness, or is this just us going into the space of our bare awareness, or does that come later?
A bare awareness? So it is bare awareness, but you have an object. So this is still shamatha with a sign, meaning that you have an object. And that's all we're going to be doing this weekend, is shamatha with an object. You know, we have an object for our mindful attention to be placed on. So it is bare awareness in the sense that it is, in the same sense that it was bare attention, focused, but focused on an object. We were focused on sensory objects earlier. And we have bare awareness focused on the mental appearances here. And so it's not awareness of awareness. Because awareness of awareness doesn't have an object. And so in this, what we are doing here, when we are focused on our mindful attention is focused on physical sensations, if a thought arises, it's a distraction. And we try to then, we relax, release, return, because that thought is not our object. We return to physical sensations. Here, we do not try to dispel thoughts that arise. We passively are aware of whatever thought, mental sensation, desire, fantasy, whatever arises, we just impassively watch it from as if they are characters on the beach passing by. And so the space of the mind is the stage, you could say, upon which, to paraphrase Shakespeare, these characters strut and fret for their moment. And then so you just watch them arise, abide. And what's interesting then? The interesting thing for me is that when you do not engage these things, which engaging them means that you have lost your spot from which you are watching these, you have lost your still point. Awareness is no longer holding its own ground because you have become cognitively fused with the appearance, and you have been chloroformed and thrown in the trunk, and you're no longer aware. You are no longer lucid. These are no longer lucid appearances, or you no longer have lucid awareness of them. Where was I going with that? When you don't engage with these things, what's interesting is to see that they seem to have a natural life expectancy. And you continue to give them life by engaging with them. Or duration. And we'll talk a lot more about that after lunch or after our break. Jen.
Wow. So this was really amazing, and I didn't have the cathedral experience, and I'm curious about that. But what I had was very intense focus on this arising, staying, and falling of whatever thought came. And So you just said that there's this life expectancy. So I noticed that. And then sometimes, though, there wasn't like the next thought. And I found myself in that space looking for one.
Ah.
And then sometimes defaulting to like the blue color that was very bright.
Uh-huh.
And so, yeah, what do you do when there's not like a natural progression into the next thought?
Cool. Yeah. Depending on the time that we have after our break, it'll either be our next meditation or the one after that, exactly what you do then. The short answer is, as you, from your still point of awareness, just notice this parade of contents. It's something similar to the volume of air reducing as you're at the tip of the nose when you relax. The sheer volume of these appearances begins to diminish. And then you just can't help but notice that there's a gap between the dissolving of this one and the arising of the next one. And so, you know, depending on how long that gap is, you know, at first it might be just a short gap, and then you know, the next one comes. And so you're just watching whatever arises in the mind. And so at some point, the gap then gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And what you do then is you take that as your object. Then what you notice is that all of these appearances, these characters that strut and fret for their moment, are like the foreground. And what you have done is to take the background as your object of meditation, which is the space of the mind in which these appearances arise. And that is why this meditation is so still. Settling the mind in its natural state is taking as the object of your mindful awareness the space of the mind and what appears there. And we started with the appearances. And what you, so you don't have to be try to bring another thought if it's not, because the real action is in the gap. Or not the real action, but you know, that's where you're going to end up. And what, without giving it all, I got to have something left to say afterwards. So this would be, unless there are any more compelling questions at the moment. Peter, you had one more thing.
Sorry. I didn't realize until Mark was describing his experience that I had closed my eyes. So if anybody's looking for a cathedral, you might have to close.
Yeah.
You might have to close your eyes.
But so that's all good feedback to, you know, that the opening your eyes and introducing this new meditation. Maybe that's a lot to just introduce at one time. You know, but just know that is what you're going to want to do at some point. Yes.
It's more a comment than a question. For me, what impressed me, because I had tried to meditate with my eyes open before, and I couldn't reach that point of meditation. This time I felt submerged in the meditation like almost immediately, and I feel it's because of that deep relaxation that I felt, yeah. that it was more relaxing for me than with my eyes closed.
Uh-huh.
And it just was amusing to, like, when you said about this, to do syllable by syllable, to say syllable by syllable, here is the mind. I was really, I felt like my mind was a spectator, like what you said was about the parade. And then everything became very soft, and I just felt like all the thoughts and my mind and the surroundings was like really, really soft, and then dual at the same time, and then it became really like fast, and they like, I don't know, both merged. And then I was just really, I don't know, impressed by that, like, watchfulness. Like, I think I got that, you know, somewhat what Jen also said, with the eyes open and I was on the blue collar, but I wasn't on the blue collar. I was in every thought going to the next, but really soft, like, sweet. And I think it was attributed to like, that relaxation that I was experiencing that was just transporting me to that place. So I just wanted to thank you, because I've tried to meditate with the eyes open and I didn't realize it's because, you know, I couldn't, you know, relax because it's distracting, like you said. But with, I don't know, with the focusing of the breath and all the other things just really took me there. The one thing that I kept thinking though was like, it's really dual and I don't understand like this duality that's coming to my heart. And so I don't know if it's something that makes any sense, but I just wanted to, you know, express how I felt.
Yeah.
So.
Great. All right. Well, there's a lot more to say and discover about that when we come back. You can have a nice lunch, and now you know that you can still meditate after lunch.
During lunch.
You might just begin to, just mindfully think of the, or experience these things as appearances, you know, all of these objects. So remember the whole thing that we talked about, this distinction between right and left hemisphere was events of perception become objects of attention. And then, of course, we believe in the object existing independently, independent of my perception of it. So you might just notice that during lunch. And we'll come back then. How about, is it possible for everybody to have lunch and get back by 3:30? That's 40 minutes. And if we do that, then we can really have more fun later. Okay, see you all at 3:30 then.